Hi, I'm Rebecca Hidalgo Rains with Grateful Heart TV, and today's guest is somebody who I am very impressed by. Recently, I got to be on his show, the Neighborhood Real Estate Show, and learned so much from Todd Bookspan that he agreed to come on to my show to share with you guys his investment tips, especially in today's market with the recession and everything else related to finance. I think it's a really good time for you to hear what he has to say about investing your money. Todd has 25 years of experience as an entrepreneur and a business leader. For the past 23 years as a mortgage originator, Todd has proven successful in cultivating both teams and branch offices. Working alongside his wife, Tara, Todd successfully helped grow the Arizona region of a mortgage bank from 5 to 85 employees at 4 branches. During his career, he and his team have funded over $1 billion in home loans while serving almost 6,000 families. Now he has designed the Win by Noon Planner as a tool to help increase productivity. On the personal side, proud father of 3 daughters, loves to run and hike with his wife Tara, and is very passionate about helping others build wealth and be more productive. Hi, I'm Rebecca Hidalgo Rains, and you're listening to Grateful Heart. I started this show to help educate my clients on the real estate market, and it's evolved into so much more. I found that I love talking to people and I love learning new things. While our expertise is still on the health of the housing market, we want to focus on the health and the well-being of our listeners as well. More specifically, where we reside in our hearts, in our minds, and in our homes. The biggest purchase in our life just isn't a house. It's where we raise our children, start a new business, pray for our loved ones, and follow our dreams. It's even where we listen to our favorite podcast. When we are successful at home, everything else just falls into place, and we are so grateful for that. Home is where the grateful heart is. Thank you for joining us today. All right, guys, we're here with Todd Bookspan. Todd, welcome to the show. Thank you for joining us today.
Oh, gosh, it's my pleasure. I'm so excited to be here.
Awesome. Well, the reason why I'm so excited is I got to be on Todd's show not that long ago. What was that, about like a month or so ago?
Yeah, and you crushed it. It was great.
It was a lot of fun. So that's us being nerds on your neighborhood real estate show. And I had so much fun with him that I needed more Todd in my life. That's why Todd's back in studio today.
Love it.
Love it. I know you also loved the feeling in my arm.
I know, that's really awkward, but yes, that's like so like, I feel like I need something cool like that.
Yeah, you know, you got the hippie Rebecca today. I went shopping over the weekend. I'm like, oh, I just love this.
I'm wearing my uniform, Win by Noon. That's like,
Win by Noon is a great uniform to have, and we're going to get into what Win by Noon is. Real quick though, before we talk about what we're here to talk about today, which is investing in today's market.
Heck yeah.
Why don't you share a little bit about your real estate show that you do, because other people would probably love to watch your show as well.
Well, I appreciate that. It's called Your Neighborhood Real Estate Show. You just go to yourneighborhoodrealestateshow.com. We're trying to keep it simple. And, you know, we just love interviewing people like yourself who just are experts on the market to try to really, you know, dig down in on a hyperlocal area to help people understand or thinking about moving somewhere specific, you know, what that's all about.
I love that. And you really do focus on certain neighborhoods with most of your guests, if I remember correctly from when I was on your show, but leave it to me to go off on a tangent.
Yeah, we went all sorts of different directions. I mean, it's truly one of the favorite episodes I've ever recorded because it was, we had so much to cover.
Yeah, I like to talk. What can I say? So thank you again for having me on. And if you guys want another podcast in your life, Your Neighborhood Real Estate Show is a great one to check out. And of course, I would love for you to check out the one I was on. So,
well, that's the best one.
Of course. You know, he just said. So we are going to hit on this. This is what he teased me with when I was on his show, is that he's big into investing and wealth building and helping others do the same. So we're going to get his ideas and advice and commentary on this article, because there's a lot of points that were brought up, and I'm curious if you agree with those points, Todd.
Well, we're going to find out.
We are going to find out, but before we do that, I'm not a PC girl.
This is really fancy. I have to say, like, my podcast is kind of cool, but like, this is like over the top.
Oh, stop it, Todd. Okay, so about the team. Todd comes to us from Fairway Mortgage. And you work with your partner, your wife, and another partner by the name of Matt, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, he's the only guy crazy enough to team up with a husband and wife. So every time there's a vote, he gets outvoted. Oh. Actually, I don't vote. I let them run all
You that. Let them run everything?
I let them run the show. And
well, I saw you had a different title, and they were co-branch managers together.
Well, yeah, because of all the coaching and training I do out in the mortgage space, you know, it keeps me out of the day-to-day.
Just so you guys know, he just finished telling me in just about 2 hours, you're getting ready to train 100 agents here in Arizona.
These are 100 loan officers all over the country.
Oh, loan officers loan all officers. Over the country. So we're not, that's way cooler than agents in Arizona. Yeah. So loan officers all over the country. And let's just be real. We are talking, I'm going to date the show. We're talking December as on the heels, mm-hmm. 2022. And the last 6 months with the interest rates where they've been, I know a lot of my colleagues in the mortgage industry have been really struggling.
Oh, yeah. I mean, as we spend a lot of time talking about mindset, because ultimately a lot of these, you know, mortgage loan officers, and I think some real estate agents too, are just struggling with the fact that business isn't as easy as it was. I felt right. like, you know, loan officers were, you know, wheeling around a wheelbarrow, you know, collecting cash as it fell out of the sky during the refinance market. And yeah. then now they have kind of lost that connection with their clients, the things that they used to do, the connections with their real estate agents that they should be doing. And so that's what I get to talk to them about.
Okay, so I'm dating myself here. I'm going to date you too. Please forgive
all right.
me, Todd.
That's all good.
Because, you know, and
his hair's gray. It's okay.
People it's okay. see well, that. Mine really is too, but I dye mine. So you wouldn't know the real color of mine. But that said, Todd and I both have been in this business for close to 30 years. And we're kind of old school. When I say kind of old school, not just our age, but you and I both like to communicate. And talk.
Oh, yeah.
And actually create relationships. And I think that is the one thing that the iBuyers today and a lot of the other companies that are out there who are trying to maybe work their way into our marketplace don't realize is so important, because when people are making the biggest investment of their lives, usually they want a human behind it. Wouldn't you agree?
Well, I 100% agree. I mean, first off, experience matters, right?
Absolutely.
In any market, experience matters. When the market, houses were flying off the shelf, people are like, oh, I can have anyone list my house. But, you know,
not
a great
really.
Agent would actually get more money and, mm-hmm. and negotiate better and all the things that would get them a better result for what they were trying to do. And so I tend to find that, right, the iBuyers and, you know, people who aren't familiar with or don't care about actually building relationship
right.
and rapport and connect with people are going to have not as great of an experience, number one, and then typically not as fruitful of a result. And then in the end, really what you want is someone who's going to be looking after you over the long term, because I tend to find that that's the biggest thing. I think that, you know, someone who has a real estate practice like you have or a mortgage mm-hmm. practice like we have, where we're following up with our clients, checking in with them continually, not just when we can refinance and make more money, but even when now when rates are high and we're checking in with clients, it's just so important.
Yeah. I mean, like, for example, we just put in the mail yesterday our holiday mailer with our mouse pad and like a newsletter for me talking about what James and I have been up to all year.
Oh,
because,
that's awesome.
You know, our clients that we've created relationships with half the time tell us how much they miss us after we close escrow, you know, and there's only so much of Rebecca to go around. So I do my best to stay in touch to keep those relationships going. And I do feel that in our industry, so many people don't understand the importance of that. So I would love that you go out there and you're educating at least the people in your sphere about how important that is.
Well, I think it's really critical. And, you know, I'm super passionate about the business, right? I'm passionate about mortgages. I'm passionate about real estate because I think it's a great opportunity for most people to build wealth, right?
Right.
83% of people's wealth at retirement, it tends to be in their home equity.
Yeah.
And so it goes back to what you said.
Wait. Okay. You need to say that stat again, because you
right.
just rambled it off so fast.
83% of most people's yeah. net worth at retirement is in their home equity. Not in their 401k, not in their bank account, but it's in their home equity.
So a stat I saw when I did a show a couple of weeks ago was the average equity in the U.S. today was $300,000.
Right. It's awesome.
It's amazing. So maybe we could talk about what you could do with that equity to make you money.
Absolutely. Right. I'm all about health, wealth, and then productivity.
Me too.
I got to find something that rhymes with that. That means productivity.
Health, wealth, and productivity. We'll find
yeah.
it. We'll figure it out. We'll figure it out before your 1 o'clock presentation today.
All right. That'd be great.
That would be great. So on the way to his presentation, I have to point out one thing on the screen, because I thought this was really cool as I stalked you online this morning.
Yeah.
We have some friends in common, Todd and I do, because we've both been working in the Valley for so long. And I actually have that same sauna on order. Please share with me your thoughts about what this is, because this does kind of go into health. You know, like, I'm all about anything healthy, financing, financial health, your physical health, your mental health. And to me, this kind of covers a lot.
Absolutely. I mean, it's the sauna and the cold plunge. So mm-hmm. if you can't see that picture, and I'm really a wimp, like that cold plunge thing, you know,
uh-huh.
I call it my not so cold plunge. I shouldn't say it out loud because it's only set at 70 right now. But when you come out of 150 degrees and you get into 70, it's still pretty cold. And we're going to lower it down like
little
5 degrees, like every couple of days until we get to the 39 degrees that everyone else
and
is
And let's
at.
Clarify, your wife is doing this with you, because I haven't had the nerve
me.
To do it yet. So when I was growing up and I lived at home with my dad still, I would go in the sauna with him, and he would usually just toss my ass right into the pool as soon as I walked out of the sauna.
So you're used to it.
I kind of experienced it.
You've been trained for it. It just, I hate the cold, right? I mean, I've lived in Arizona for too long.
But the benefits are that it fires off all those new neurons in your brain, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the health effects of the sauna is all the brain health mm-hmm. and cardiovascular health is mm-hmm. really what you're doing. So, you know, I kind of joke, I'm training for old age right now.
But that's true.
Well, absolutely. Absolutely. And so that's really important, the brain and the cardiovascular part. And then the cold plunge is all about inflammation, right? Yeah. So it's about reducing inflammation because really inflammation's the arch enemy of most disease and all that stuff is caused by that. So my wife and I are planning to live a long life together. We've been married for 32, almost 33 years.
Congratulations to you guys.
So that's exciting. Got married young. You know, this, like I said, it is real gray hair, but, but nonetheless. And so that's just one more part of it. And my friend who, our mutual friend who has one of these, he's like, there's no way two people can get in one, but this is the new one that's a foot longer. So actually my wife and I both get in at the same time.
Oh gosh. Yeah. Okay.
But it's much more fun. It's easier when you have a partner do it, accountability.
Yeah.
And then you can both sit there and shiver together.
Yeah. So our colleague who talked about it in my mastermind group did light a fire under my husband. And after Jonas had educated us about this, he decided in the middle of the winter to go jump in our pool.
Yeah.
And he came out and said he'd never do that again. Yeah. So it's not for everybody, but it is really cool. And I wanted to share that because what I think is really cool is that you're all about giving back, mm-hmm. but at the same time, you're also about self-care. And there's something about taking care of yourself first before you can really serve others.
Yeah, it's that whole cliche thing, right? You put the oxygen mask on yourself first and then you put it on your child.
Yeah.
Because ultimately, if you're not at your best, how can you really be your best for other people? And so for me, you know, I'm really fortunate because I get to serve on the loan side and help people who are doing mortgages and really build a better financial future by, you know, making sure they've got the proper financing, not just today, but in the future. And then on the coaching side, I'm having just a blast helping other people really spread that message to even more people, right? So it's that magnification, I guess you'd call it.
Yeah. And we're going to talk about that in just a minute. But before we get there, the first time I actually met you.
Things.
Yeah, you're like, you do so much cool stuff. I want to make sure I highlight all of it, Todd. So Women of Strength is something I've been attending for many, many years now. It's something that your company puts on with the help of Susie Lavenda. Can you share what that is about for anybody who's curious, like Women of Strength and this guy is putting it on? What's this about?
Yeah, I mean, it's all about inspire, mentor, and lead. Mm-hmm. And, you know, really when Susie came up with the event about 10 years ago, and so it's just something our team has been super passionate about, you know, and it was one of those things where she came up with the idea that really there's just not enough women leaders in our industry. And there's just also this competition sometimes and people aren't always there to try to work together.
Yeah.
And so for me, as soon as she said she did, it was already done anyway. So it's not like I could have rewound it, but I was like, of course, let's be all in on this event. So it's always great, you know, every year now to have over 500 folks in there. And it's an interesting event too, because it's put on by my mortgage team. You know, we're up there speaking, Matt mm-hmm. and I, and then we've got, you know, not just great real estate companies that are buying tables for their top agents, title companies buying tables for their top agents, but also other mortgage companies come up at our show up at our event. So it's really cool that we have
it's
that impact.
It's super cool. And in fact, I think the last one, I was so impressed by one of the speakers you guys had. I literally stalked her wanting to try to talk to her myself because she was so badass at literally going out there and presenting it. I think her name was Erin. She was the one who they did a movie on.
Do yeah.
You know who I'm talking about? Like, she was so amazing. So you guys bring wonderful content. And for anybody in Arizona in the Valley who's in our industry, if you haven't attended one of those events, you absolutely should. Now, that said, before we're going to get into stocks and advice, I want to talk about this other thing that you do, because this is what you're sounds like you're the most passionate about. And you're wearing your shirt, as you called your uniform.
My uniform.
Your uniform.
It just makes it easy, right?
Yeah.
You know, Steve Jobs.
So you don't have to think about what you're putting on today.
I just put on something that says Win by Noon every day.
So Win by Noon. It's a quick start to start your quarter off right. I know right now it sounds like you directed at loan officers and agents. But then I saw on your website you had like a... What did I put up? Where is it?
We've got insurance agent.
The executive edition. Yeah, so it really could apply to anybody.
Really anyone in sales. I mean, that's a sales version of it. We started out because, you know, we always think about what we do. And so I started out with a loan officer version. It's really how I grew my business 45% in 1 year was sort of following what I call the ideal week and really getting the most important things that I knew I had to get done more consistently because I made it a priority. And so, you know, as soon as we had that, this is super going
to
fall apart and all that.
Yeah, I was going to say, I have to have you hold it up.
This one's kind of cool too because this is our secret one. It's the plug and play social media edition.
Ooh.
And so we have a new version of that coming
up. Wait.
Just be careful. It's like full of, it's got my calendar in there and it's got like.
Oh, you mean you don't mean just to throw it?
Well, no, just like if you're like, there's just stuff that's going to fall out, you know, like, you know, important piece of mail. But
so, you know, I have to tease you because we're old school. this is in writing. This
it's
is not
paper.
This
it's
is paper. Deal. This is not like an app or a reminder or an alert. This is, you carry this around.
Yeah, it's really recording the activities that you do and tracking the results, right? Because you know in real estate,
yes,
it's not a mystery, right? If you want to close a transaction, there's a certain amount of activities you have to do every day in order to get there. And most people just go, oh, I close a transaction, yay, but they don't, and I want to close more, but they don't really know what it takes to close more. And so this is just a way for people to help business plan and create a strategy to understand, you know, what they're doing with more clarity, you know, day in and day out. And so it's been kind of fun for us because we're kind of coaching agnostic. So we've got, you know, the biggest mortgage companies in the country, the biggest coaching groups in the country use this as their way. They might have a digital thing that they all put their numbers in at the end of the week, but on
day
to day, they all sit this here. So every coaching organization has that in common.
So, you know, one thing I want to point out to anybody who's watching our show, who's in real estate, any form, you know, it's not magic. There's very simple things that you and I both do regularly that has put us in the position that we're in our careers today. And it's basic stuff. Like,
yeah, it's
actually
not rocket science.
Yeah, not rocket science. And it's funny, a colleague, or I shouldn't say colleague, she's newly licensed, a friend of mine. She went to a different brokerage on, you know, whatever. Cool. It's actually Kevin's
Shocking.
Brokerage. I know it happens. And I was chatting with her this morning. She hasn't really gone far with it. And she's like, you know, I really just need to learn how to sell a house. And I'm like, girl, you're overthinking it. You know how many people go and get their real estate license and never do anything with it?
A huge amount. I mean, I recently looked at the statistic and it was kind of crazy to see the number of licensed agents in Arizona who didn't even do any transactions.
So years ago when I was in a recruiting phase, I looked up, and I'm sure this won't shock you, but it might shock some of our audience hearing these numbers. I looked up to see how many agents in our valley actually sold one house a month. I mean, because if you don't sell at least one house a month,
it's not very many.
If you don't sell one house a month, how do you pay your mortgage? How do you pay for your food? How do you pay for your gas, right? You're not full-time, in my opinion, unless you can at least knock out one sale a month.
I would agree.
Right? Wouldn't you agree? Okay. Less than 5% of all the agents licensed, and we're talking 70,000 agents, can claim that.
If it's even close to 5%, I would be shocked. And I think the
challenge
is—
It was less than 5.
So here's what I think, though. I think number one is then who's— Are you really getting a great experience? I think it's a challenge because everyone knows a real estate agent that could be a cousin, a brother, a sister, a coworker.
Every person knows at least 8 agents.
Right. And so the challenge always is, you know, because on the mortgage side, we're really fortunate. We get lots of referrals from clients and they come with their agent attached. And we'll work with their agent and we'll coach
them. You work
with
any agent.
But I would say that the end result, though, is always better with someone who's super experienced because, again, they know how to negotiate. They've been around in other markets. So this market isn't something new and different to them.
In fact, I was excited as the market shifted because I'm like, woohoo! Selling houses again.
Yeah, absolutely. And I do think it's a little sad. I see a lot of posts of like, now everyone's going to quit the business for loans. I see that for real estate. Like now it's not only the stronger are going to survive. And I don't like that because my whole goal is to help people. That's why my group coaching for loan officers is really geared towards people that aren't consistently closing 5 loans a month. There's plenty of people who will coach you if you're, you know, closing 1 million loans.
So it's kind of like what I just said about the average agent is not selling one house a month. You want to help the average loan officer that maybe isn't hitting those numbers either.
I got that heart there, you know, it's kind of crazy. Everyone's like, why would you sell what you want to sell what you have to the people who can't afford what it is you do. So I said, you're right, I can't. I mean, I used to coach top loan officers in the country, CEOs, and now I just say, gosh, I'll just put a lot of them in a call and then therefore the economics work.
I think the thing that you and I can definitely share with those that we have the fortunate ability to share with is this too shall pass. You know,
absolutely.
Our market's always going to be cyclical, but my advice to most people trying to get into our line of work is that you need to have at least a year's worth of savings. Yeah. And I think that's what I'm hearing for those that are getting out of the business. They were the ones that probably leading up to this weren't positioned the way they should. They didn't carry around one of these.
Exactly.
They didn't get organized. They didn't have systems in place so that they could be successful in any marketplace. And I feel like what you're offering is something so critical because it's not rocket science. It's pretty basic stuff. You know, you pick up the phone and you write stuff down.
Well, just have a plan, right? I mean, that's ultimately it. Have a plan and where you're trying to go. And it's, again, because I never want someone to not want to get in the business, right? I mean, it's the world's best business, right?
I love it.
If you do real estate or mortgage, I mean, I think there's no better opportunity to serve people in what's such an important decision.
Yeah, I agree. It's the best thing that we have to offer. But that said, you just did this a couple months ago in Vegas. You were in September talking about recession-proof your business. So you're just full of all kinds of advice for people in our line of work, right?
You know, it's funny too, because at that conference, you know, I was super fortunate to be on the stage, and it was, you know, kind of all my heroes of the mortgage business were on there. And like, they're talking about interest rates and all these exciting things. And then I get on there and talk about
mindset. Like,
well, and do what you got to do, what you know you have to do, yeah, and accountability and things that no one really wants to hear. But nonetheless, it's just, it's the message that's so important, right? It's really the right time for that message.
It really is the right time. And you know, one thing, I was just chatting with a friend recently, and I feel like whether it's business or life, you're just being responsible for yourself. And when you take responsibility for where you're at in your life, whether it's your career, your family, your relationships, but when you take responsibility for where you are today, that's how you get to where you want to be tomorrow. Because until you own up and maybe make those tweaks and maybe make those corrections that you know you should be doing, like, let's get up in the morning and write our day out. What do I have to do today? And make sure you got your list and you're checking it twice. It's not that hard to communicate and to really wow people if you have those right systems. So I love that you're sharing all of that and you're talking to people about recession, because that's what gets everybody so scared. And now let's talk money, because that's usually where gets most people is in their pocketbook, well, right?
It's funny too, because that's really at that conference where I decided I was going to talk more about building wealth in 2023, because I just feel like that's how I can mix what I think is most important for people who want to stay in the business. Yeah. Like, hey, this is what you have to do. But ultimately, then on the other side, let's figure out how to actually build and retain wealth.
Okay. So you just said before we started the show, and I'm going to poke on you just because Warren Buffett owns Berkshire Hathaway, right? And that's where my license is currently held.
He's a smart guy.
Pretty smart. Known as one of the most top investors of the, you know, of our ever our lifetime, right? And he has a very famous saying, to be fearful when others are fearless and to be fearless when others are fearful. And I feel like, and I know for a fact, that's how he's maneuvered a lot of his acquisitions. And I want to commend you on the fact that you're putting your money where your mouth is and you're closing on 10 properties tomorrow.
10.
When so many people are scared to get off that fence. Like, I have been like singing to the choir, you're my choir, that there's some great opportunities today, but there's so much fear. Well, let's all be Warren or let's all be Todd and let's go buy some properties when everybody else is fearful, because when you're fearless, when everybody else is fearful, it seems to equate to wealth.
Right. And it's also having a plan, right? So, I mean, I knew what the numbers need to look like in order for it to make financial sense for me to proceed. And therefore, I look for the opportunity. And when everyone else, you just said, whenever it's is fearful, then that typically leads to opportunity. And ultimately, this was something that someone else probably passed on that made the opportunity there for me. And, you know, my goal is to really figure out, well, how do I want to build my wealth in the future the same way I teach, you know, clients and others to do so.
So hang on real tight. We're going to take a quick commercial break and Todd's going to tell us the rest of his tips.
If you're looking for a mortgage, you need a personalized plan, not a click button get mortgage option. My team and I have saved families thousands by proactively planning their home purchase or a refinance. Buying a home is a huge decision and it deserves a strategic approach. My team and I provide a comprehensive mortgage plan, including a complete credit analysis outlining the steps needed to improve your credit score and help you qualify for the best rates and terms in the market. Visit us at tkteam.us today. We'll ensure you get the best guidance so you can make the best decisions. The TK Team, moving you forward.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Hidalgo-Raines with Berkshire Hathaway Home Services, and I've been selling homes here in the Valley for over a quarter of a century. I want to say that experience truly matters, so when you're looking for a realtor to help you either buy or sell your biggest purchase of your life, I hope you'll consider using me. My experience doesn't matter near as much as my clients, so I do dare you to Google me, and I promise you'll see nothing but fantastic reviews, because I really do truly care to help navigate you and your family to the very best experience you'll ever have with buying a home.
Have you been thinking about buying a new house or refinancing your existing mortgage? Interest rates are still around historically low levels. Why pay a higher rate when you don't have to? Call Joe Smith, me, at Epic Mortgage LLC, 602-741-4121 for a free mortgage quote or pre-qualification. Epic Mortgage LLC is a locally owned, independent mortgage brokerage that provides low-cost options for its customers. Independently owned means low overhead, so you get the best rates, fees, and service. Keep more of your money. Brokers are better. Realtor recommended for over 20 years? Contact me, Joe Smith, at Epic Mortgage today, 602-741-4121.
Whether purchasing a home or refinancing, we know you have choices when it comes to choosing a title company. Navi Title Agency is the leading source for all title, escrow, and marketing needs. With access to the largest title insurance underwriter, Navi Title facilitates successful closings and protects clients from fraud. Creating solutions that save time and money for everyone, ask your realtor or loan officer today about using Navi Title on your next real estate transaction. Navi Title Agency is locally owned and operated in the state of Arizona.
All right, guys, we're back. And this is the screen that I started our show with. You know, Todd teased me a little bit when I was on his show last time about how he could teach me a thing or two when it came to investing. So
I don't know if I could teach you more than you already know, but I just love talking about it.
I love talking about it, too.
We could have a conversation about it.
I'm just teasing you, Todd. So that said, I saw this article and I really wanted to get his take because it sounded to me like you're a little bit more invested in Wall Street than I personally am. I have a and actually, when I was on your show, we did talk a little bit about crypto. I actually just got all my team certified in crypto, and you were just like, okay, whatever, Rebecca. You know,
like, no, I'm like super excited to learn more about that because that's one of the areas where I know this much.
Well, I learned a whole bunch more recently, and it got me motivated because, again, I was kind of thinking about be fearless when others are fearful, and they have had some incredible bad news in the media recently with FTX collapsing and all these other things. But the thing is if you don't know about what's happening, there are homes being sold with crypto and as NFTs. And if that language isn't something you understand, you should learn more. I think we should always be learning more anyways. That's why I wanted to learn from you about your thoughts when it came to investing. So Jeremy Siegel sees stocks soaring 30% in 2 years and house prices dropping 15% from their peak. Now, he's talking generalities. We're in Arizona. It's hard, you know, for us to probably give our opinions based off of maybe our biased opinions, what
Absolutely.
We see here. I think I'm like sunshine, happy-go-lucky, because Arizona seems to be in such a better position than a lot of other places in the country.
Absolutely.
When it comes to real estate and why people would be moving in instead of out. But that said, do you agree with that?
I mean, I think there's places that you'll see houses drop 15%, but those are probably the places that people are moving from to come here to Arizona because they want to live a different lifestyle, right? The lifestyle that we can have without having snow and rain and all the other things that these
all
people
the healthy
have to deal with.
Running out and hiking
exactly.
and doing fun stuff like that. 30% in 2 years, though, that was what really caught my eye because the stocks have really been volatile in the last year. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, and I think there's this misinformation out there, right? That stocks over history have, you know, it depends who you read, 8%, 10%, whatever that is. But, you know, you can have stocks go, you know, people think that means every year it goes up 10%. But the problem is a year like this year where they're on 25 to 30%, then if it only goes up 10% next year, because it could do that, you still have this big, huge loss. So it takes a lot to get that back. And that's where I think the folks who are selling stocks and selling mutual funds are misleading people on that's the best place to park all of your money.
Mm-hmm.
And I do dabble, you know, over in that area and I pay attention there. But so I think 30%, I mean, that is potentially realistic, but, you know, 30% increase after 30% drop doesn't get you back to zero. If you had $100,000 and you lose 30%, that's $70,000. If you gain 30% from there, that's $21,000. You're at $91,000. So you're still underwater by 9%, right? So, you know, again, it all depends on how it all works out. But the bottom line is that it's certainly possible it could shoot up because there's a lot of money on the sidelines. Everyone's like, yay, I can't wait for stocks to go back up. And so once everyone decides it's time to buy, it'll go up.
Exactly. And you know, it's so funny, like a couple things. I didn't want to interrupt you because you're on
the
flow.
I know, I saw you were ready to go. And I was like, all right.
Ready to jump in there. But you know, listening to you talk about this, it really just kind of makes me think that at the end of the day, stock market is not for day traders, that's gambling.
It is.
And if you're invested in stocks, it's not that you want to be buying and selling on a daily basis. It's you should probably buy and let it sit and ride it out because of what you just said. And it was so quick. How quick did you do that math in your head?
Well,
you know, it was pretty cute. How quick you were like, yeah, you're still upside down.
I need a calculator normally, but.
Well, stop it. But the clickbait there. Because, you know, if you look at it, you're like, stocks are going to rise 30%. And I guess it's cool if you weren't already losing 30% from maybe the loss that you had last year and you're just getting into it. But, you know, there's misleading headlines all over the place. The Fed initially overlooked the inflation threat and now it's hiking rates too fast, he said. Would you agree with that statement?
I would agree with that statement. I mean, the challenge is that we have inflation and that hurts the average person more than, you know, anyone else. I did a video yesterday for that I sent to some of my real estate agents on showing what the, you know, the average person, like 80% of people are barely making the line for what it costs to live with a family of four. And that to me is super sad.
That's super sad, right? And scary.
Yeah. And so, I mean, we all see it, right? Gas prices are still high. Grocery prices are high. Eating out is expensive. All the things that, you know, people need to do in order to stay. I think the only, you know, glimmer of hope is that inventories are high. And unfortunately, stores who they had to over-order because stuff wasn't available before, now we're going to have to potentially discount that to get it out. So really, that's all the Fed's trying to do is they're trying to slow inflation, which is what they have to do. But it was their own fault. I mean, they let it get too hot. I mean, they were doing all the things to fuel the fire.
They put too much money into our economy to stimulate it, in my opinion. From what I heard, they printed more money during the COVID quarantine than we have in our entire history, unless I'm misinformed.
No, you're right. And in the statistics that I look at that are really sad to me right now is look at the number of when you saw during COVID, savings were at an all-time high, right? Because everyone was getting checks from the government. And so it was great. People actually put them in the bank, right? Yeah. And they weren't moving around and traveling, do all the things that they were normally spending money on. And then debt then actually came down. So debt was low, savings were high. And then fast forward here now, you know, less than 2 years later,
debt is incredibly high.
At all-time high, revolving debt. All the expensive debt is super, super high. And then savings is now back at historical lows. And so we've just had this quick flip-flop, and that's inflation. So that's what the Fed's attempting to do. But then they're making car loans, they're making credit cards, all that stuff more expensive. And so that's difficult. They're obviously impacting housing and the things that we deal with every day. But what will happen is then historically they overdo it, and then they have to let it go the other direction. Yeah. So it's just a matter of being prepared for when that change happens.
You know, an old boss of mine years ago, and it still sticks with me, he gave the analogy of the pendulum swinging.
Yeah, it's a great one.
And it's a great one because when he said that, it was 2006.
Oh, yeah.
And I was a new home sales manager with 28 agents under me, and he was my boss there. And, you know, he was trying to calm the fears that we were seeing. Well, of course, none of us had the foresight to see what was coming down our pipe in that era. Do you believe that today we are anywhere where we were, say, in 2006, 2007?
You know, from which perspective? From like the economy or from housing or?
Well, just in general, because there was, again, a lot of fear back then.
I think we're better off in some areas and worse off in others.
I want to hear where we're worse off.
I think we're worse off in the fact that we don't really know what's this recession going to look like. If we're at the very beginning and we're not really in a recession, no one will say we're in a recession, but most people believe.
Feel we are.
Yeah, I mean, the smart people all believe that the likelihood maybe of a recession is, I saw two different statistics. One was like 68% of smart people all said we're going to have a recession. And it's just gone up every month. And another one, I mean, there's just so many different signs to point to that we're heading to a recession. And so the question is, if we're already have a lack of savings, and we already have high debt, where do we go from here? And that's where I think, I just feel for the average normal person,
the average Joe,
they're going to get hurt by this. And just like we saw in COVID, the wealthy are crushing it, right? Yeah. They're taking advantage of it because they look at things differently than everyone else. I mean, everyone else is sold to put your money in the stock market and they're like, oh, hey, maybe I'm going to put my money over here instead.
Okay. So you made a very good point. And this is the point, I'm sure, of where you're educating people whenever you have that opportunity, is the wealthy think different than the average Joe.
Absolutely.
And is there something in particular that you could give advice to the average Joe on that would help them maybe think more like the wealthy?
Well, I already mentioned that my wife, what we talked about beforehand, is a non-practicing attorney. So I have to tell you, I'm not a financial advisor, a CPA.
That's your disclaimer.
Nor do I play one on TV.
Neither do I.
Right.
But I know enough to be dangerous, and so do you.
Well, I think there's a lot of things out there that other people think are bad investments that there's an opportunity with for people. So, you know, things like whole life insurance for a lot of people may be a good alternative to the stock market to put some of their money into that's done differently than they would get from their normal insurance agent. But there's certain agents who would, what I would specialize in something called infinite banking, who would say, hey, maybe you can set this up differently now and you have a different result down the road. And again, it's not, some people would say, put all your money in there. I would say, hey, put some of your money in there. I think there's just different ways to diversify.
Are you talking about a self-directed IRA where you can borrow against it?
That would be a similar thing, yeah. Mm-hmm. But when you have a policy like that, and I'm no expert in it, but
you're talking about the insurance.
When you have the insurance policy, it earns money. You can borrow it out and invest in other things. Self-directed IRA, another great opportunity. I mean, I set that up for my kids, right? I helped them set up their, you know, of working age now, and I helped them invest their money in there, and they're going to self-direct it and then use that to grow their wealth.
I had my trust attorney on this last year, and I thought his advice was really, really good in the sense that even when you don't have very much to start with, to set up a trust is really, really smart.
Oh, absolutely.
Because it gets your mind going in that direction of leaving something behind for those you love, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And just going through that process for me, like, who's going to get this? Who's going to get that? And, oh my gosh, I want to make sure I'm leaving, you know, something, a legacy behind for my children and my grandchildren, you know, one day. And I don't think I would have been thinking that way had I not gone through that process. And that is something that you see every person who's wealthy have is a trust.
Well, and I think absolutely it's super important. My dad was a trust attorney before he retired this year. So
okay.
I got a trust for like my first anniversary. I was like, yay, all right, thanks, Dad. but it was really important because now I see people who have passed away and then they're having to have their estates go through probate instead of having something that's pretty easy up front to distribute the money the way that you wanted it to go. But I always think it's my question of the week. I get a new question every week. My question of the week is who are you getting your financial advice from? Because if you're getting financial advice, I mean, I love my parents, but I learned differently about money from them. My dad was super cheap with money, attorney.
Rich dad, poor dad kind of
thing. And my mom just wrote checks. As long as there was money in checks in the checkbook, she was spending money, like it was going out of style. And so I just had this conflicting way of what do I do when I grow up? And, you know, they've done well for themselves, which is great, but I don't feel like I learn. So I find a lot of people learn from either parents or they follow some celebrity, you know, money person. And you just have to decide, well, what's behind it? You know, how did they do? And is that the best person to get advice from?
I love it. Okay, well, we're running out of time quickly.
All right, so which one of these stocks you want to, or which one of these stock things you want to talk about?
Let's see. You know what? I'm just going to, we're going to put this stuff on our show outtake so you guys can see the article that I'm talking about. And quite frankly, honestly, Todd, I'd rather just know from you, where do you have your money invested in Wall Street? Like, are there any tips that you would share with people, or are you thinking real estate today because of today's economic environment we're in, or do you like to be diversified?
You know, I like to be diversified. I mean, I would say that I'm not putting any new money into the market. And so it's a weird thing. And, you know, I'm always really careful because I got a lot of friends who are financial advisors. And so I've got my retirement account that are my IRAs, which I shouldn't say it, but I'm about to self-direct. Mm-hmm. So he doesn't know that they're going to move. But what I find is financial advisors, they put your money in, they say to stay the course. And they do this. And so I follow other people who are, I would say, more connected to what's going on in the market. And so I actually took the stuff that I controlled, some of my work 401k and then my personal accounts, and I moved that to cash. And then I moved some stuff to defensive positions like gold back then. So that made sense to me to do.
So you have money in gold.
And so, yeah, and gold hasn't done that well, by the way, but it's there because just who knows how it's going to go. So you put some stuff there and just money sitting that's ready to look for opportunity, like the properties that I'm buying in Nebraska. And so I think it's one of those things you have to find someone you trust and you have to bucket your money with, you know, I'm happy to leave some money with a financial advisor and let them manage it so I don't take more risk than I should because I tend to have that desire. and I think just be comfortable with what you put your money into. But if you can't afford to lose it, then you shouldn't be putting it at risk.
Awesome. And so that said, I want to direct really to our average Joe who's certainly struggling today. If they're barely able to make their bills with their debts and everything else they have, do you still advise to put money into savings while they're trying to work off debt?
You know, it's really tough because I always like to see people have 3 months of savings first and then pay off debt.
Uh-huh.
But it's really hard. I mean, if your debt's, you know, at 29% credit card, it makes it really,
really
difficult. But, you know, the last thing that you want to do is pay off a debt and be really happy that you did it and then, you know, have the tire blow out on your car and have to go charge more tires on your credit card. I mean, that's just unfortunately part of the cycle. But, you know, normally it's the whole idea of, you know, the cash flow priority model is, you know, whatever you feel is comfortable, 3 to 6 months. You said 12 months if you're going to be a brand new real estate agent in savings, then pay off all that revolving debt and then start saving for good things, right? Then you can save to invest or buy real estate. And I think it's, you know, again, look at the people that you're getting advice from and are they wealthy? Because a lot of people who make a lot of money, you might think they're rich, but they're not really wealthy. And that's, to me, the most interesting observation I've had over the last decade.
Okay, so that is a huge nugget. And please re-say that again, because that would, like, somebody could just blow right over. Just because you earn a lot doesn't mean what?
It doesn't mean you're wealthy. I mean, you could be rich in cash, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, people make fun of me. I mean, I drove a Prius for, you know, the first five, you know, for 5 years when I was making a lot of money. And they're like, oh, well, maybe Todd's not that successful. I mean, even now, you saw me, I'm driving a Ford pickup truck.
Yeah.
I mean, it's expensive Ford pickup truck.
Actually, well, most trucks expensive, are expensive.
Most expensive car I've ever owned. But, you know, oftentimes people are like, oh, wow, that person's got a flashy car. But, you know, did they, you know, borrow money and they have, you know, they're robbing Peter to pay Paul, that kind of thing. And so I think it's just a matter of really asking better questions is what I'm trying to do of people who I'm seeing have money to see mm-hmm. whether it's wealth or whether they're just trying to portray it.
Portray it. Well, and that's a fair statement because I used to do new home sales, and half the time the people who came into our sales office, the flashiest with the nicest cars, struggled to qualify, where somebody who looked very unassuming actually was really well off. And that might be why they were well off, because they were unassuming and weren't spending what they shouldn't spend.
You know, it was our kind of our ongoing joke, you know, during the refi boom was how many people couldn't qualify for the loan that they wanted because of their really expensive Tesla lease. I mean, there was, you know, just crazy, and people would be disappointed. And so I think car loans has been a really big challenge, and mm-hmm. you have to have reliable transportation. So I don't, you know, I don't disagree with that, but that's really been the people who couldn't take advantage of buying a house when rates were lower. Oftentimes it was their car payment. That was the biggest issue.
That's sad. Well, I don't know what to say about that, because you can't, like you say, you can't be without a car, at least not here in Arizona, maybe in other cities where you can walk to work and walk everywhere, but kind of need one here. So hopefully the interest rates come down so the payments aren't so bad, because I think that is definitely something that I see a lot of times with clients who call me. The average Joe, once they get that brand new car, they could kiss that house goodbye, which is really sad to me. I want everybody who with an average income to be able to afford a home. Because that is the way that most people end up with wealth at the end of their lives.
It's the American dream, right? I mean, you know, who wants to raise a family and then not be able to paint the walls the color your kid wants the walls, or not have a backyard for your dog to run around? All those things that people say. It sounds kind of cliche, but
it's true.
It really is the American dream. And I just, you know, I never take it lightly when I'm able to help somebody do that. But, you know, the flip side is if you're a parent listening, so we talked about investing before.
Yeah.
If you're a parent listening and you've got a son or a daughter who's younger, maybe not in a position financially to buy a house, maybe think about going on the loan with them as a co-borrower, non-occupant co-borrower.
Yep.
And then
just did that for my firstborn.
You can gift them the down payment, mm-hmm. Or maybe have, you know, figure out some, you know, some arrangement there through a down payment grant program or some other way, and help them get in a home to be a homeowner versus a renter. Now. And then that could be the house that they move out of and rent and then turns into there. Cause that's transparently the one great thing I learned from my parents that my parents did for me. I bought my first house at 19. I had two roommates. They paid all but $60 of the mortgage, and that house
perfect. What a great investment.
Became my first rental house, and really is what sort of set me up for success.
I would encourage everybody watching, if you have a child who can't buy a house but you could help them, I actually totally agree with you. I just did the same thing for my daughter this past year, because without my help, she wouldn't have been able to have the American dream.
Yeah.
And you know what? Thank you again for coming on, Todd, because the American dream is really what I'm passionate about. Obviously, you
Heck
are,
yeah.
And we want to make sure that we can help as many people achieve that dream as possible. Thanks, you guys, for listening today, and we'll be back with you again soon.
Thank you so much, Rebecca.
Thanks, Todd.
Have a blast. Thanks, everyone.
Super fun. Todd Bookspan just left our studio, and he was so cool for coming and talking to us about investing in today's recession that we may or may not be in, and just talking all things like to be winning by noon. His coaching program was super cool. I love the fact that he carries around a day planner with him. And he also gives a lot of advice on social media. So if you're in my line of work or in his line of work, you need to check him out with Win by Noon, because he could maybe help you with your business. What a great show. And thank you for joining us on our mutual journey to becoming unharmable and successful in all of our experiences while we're here in this school of life. We hope you enjoyed it. If you watched us on YouTube, please like and subscribe so you don't miss any future episodes. Likewise, if you're catching us on one of our podcast platforms, be sure to follow us so you never miss out on another one of our shows again. Remember that if you ever have a question about real estate or any of the other topics we cover, check us out on the web, www.gratefulheart.tv, for all of our links to connect with us. I'm on vacation every single day, 'cause I love my occupation. Hey, I'm on vacation every single day, every single day.